I'm sorry, I don't think I was on yet, so some of y'all aren't awake yet, so let's try it again. Good morning. Now we're awake. Welcome to St. John's. We're so glad to have all of you here with us to worship God and fellowship and Christian love. So, I have a few announcements for us to go over. The first is the flowers in the sanctuary are given to the glory of God and in memory of Andy and Estelle Faudel and Mr. and Mrs. John F. Boyette, Sr., by the Boyette family. Our Wednesday night programming will begin on August 2nd, that's this Wednesday, and there's going to be lots of excitement going on with that. Please check out in the bulletin for more details than what I can give you, but it'll be time for study, children's and youth programs, fellowship, and a Wednesday night supper, and a time for the whole family and the entire church family to come together. If you plan to eat on Wednesday night, though, we do need to know at the church office to sign up no later than by tomorrow, Monday at 5. We also want you to mark your calendars for August 13th from 5 to 6:30, because we will be doing our Tailgates to Touchdowns back to school party. The tents will be provided to Sunday school classes that wish to decorate tailgate spots, and we have a special treat that Cocky and the Tiger will be present to help lead the spirited night. If your Sunday school class wishes to participate, please sign up at Miss Kara Robinson's office in the office. If you have any questions, please contact Emily Murphy or Amber Bates. And I heard that there will be a young pastor and potentially a Dunkin' booth if you would like to make donations. He should be wearing an orange shirt, so all you Garnet fans will have can make good big and large donations for that. Our bulletin, again, is full of important things, but I have a personal special announcement that I need to make, is that we have a sixth grade Sunday school class that's just getting going. It's been going before this, but we need volunteers to help with that Sunday school class. You don't have to be there every week. The Sunday school teacher is yours truly, and that's why we need plenty of volunteers to help with that. If you need to know what it sounds like, all right, when God is not touching you on the shoulder and encouraging you, inviting you to be a volunteer in Sunday school class, this is what it sounds like. We need you to be at Sunday school. Okay? All right, this is what it sounds like. All right? So, if you'd like to volunteer to teach or to lead or to just help with the Sunday school class for our safe sanctuary policy to make sure our children are kept safe, please just contact Kara Robinson to sign up. I would like to also take the time now to remind you that if you like free trade coffee, that we, the mission leadership team, will be selling coffee over in the educational building in between the Faith Center and here, and that will be next Sunday, the first Sunday of the month. We also want to remind our youth that are between the eight grades of 7th and 12th that we will be meeting tonight in Ward Hall from 5 to 6:30 p.m. for a special time of food, fun, and fellowship while we hear our youth about the mission programs they have participated in this spring and summer. Also, please note that our Shepherd of Love ministry will be meeting Wednesday, August 2nd, that's this Wednesday, at 4:30 in room 119. And then also a very exciting announcement is that Dr. Tim's Wednesday morning Bible study will resume at 10 a.m. in the sanctuary August 23rd. He will resume our study of God's deliverance beginning in Deuteronomy. At this time, I would like to invite Mr. Stephen Lathrop to come forward.
Good morning. Every Christian is called to care for others. and our Stephen ministry is a powerful way several of us have committed to living out that care. Today, we're specifically recognizing our newest Stephen leader to organize, teach, and supervise our Stephen ministers as they train the trained caregivers who provide the high-quality, one-to-one care to hurting people in our congregation and community. I invite our new Stephen leader, Don Hayes, to step forward, please. Don, you have been trained through the Stephen Ministry Leaders Training Course and have been asked to serve as a Stephen leader at St. John's United Methodist Church. You are a gift of God to us, helping lead this ministry of equipping and caring.
Let's have a prayer for Don. Let's do that first. Now let's pray together. You may want to lay hands on Don. Lord Jesus, we give you thanks for Don and pray that you bless him. Use him as a Stephen leader. We're so grateful for this ministry that connects people with those who can offer care and connects them with you. So Lord Jesus, we pray that you increase our Stephen ministers and that you increase our care receivers and that you give us an opportunity to make a difference in the Aiken community by sharing with others. We thank you for Don and for Denise, and we pray that you bless Don and lead him in this ministry of being in the leadership of Stephen ministry. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you.
Please remain standing as we affirm our faith using the historic Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. Third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. At this time, I will invite our ushers to come forward for the morning offering. please be seated. At this time, we invite all of our children to come forward and meet Dr. Tim at the altar for our children's sermon.
Come on down. All righty. You know, sometimes starting school can be stressful. Have a seat, John Wesley. Sometimes starting school can be, you know, bothersome. It can be nerve-wracking, getting used to a new teacher, or a new teacher getting used to us, you know, new rules, different classrooms, all kinds of changes. And so sometimes we feel like we really need God's help. And you know, frankly, I think everybody of every age, hey girls, need God's help. So there's a passage of scripture from 2 Chronicles, is one of my favorites from the Old Testament. It's about the people of Israel, the people of Judah in particular, who are surrounded by a bunch of armies, and they are out to get them. And so Jehoshaphat is the king of Judah, and he prays a prayer, and he says, God, we need your help. And so God answers Jehoshaphat, and this is what it says. It's in 2 Chronicles chapter 20, and then verse 15. Listen, King Jehoshaphat, and all who live in Judah and Jerusalem, this is what the Lord says to you, and this is what he says to us. Do not be afraid or discouraged because of this vast army that is coming against you, for the battle is not yours, but God's. Do not be afraid, don't be discouraged, for the battle is not yours, but God's. So I brought with me something that I bet you might recognize. What is this a symbol of? What company uses this logo? What is it? It's a lot of shoes in the malls. It's guess what, John Wesley? Let's talk about this. What is this the symbol of? It is the symbol of the company. Everybody who knows it, say it out loud. Nike. And Nike is a Greek word that means victory. And so the Nike company wanted to make sure that everybody who wore their t-shirts that had the swoosh on it, or their sneakers that had the swoosh on them, this symbol is the symbol for Nike. It means victory. So it's a way for people to be encouraged, if they're wearing a swoosh like this, that it means that they are winners. And that's what that passage of scripture is saying, that even though we might be surrounded by a lot of armies and people and things that are trying to get us, we can trust in God, and Jesus will take care of us, and we can be winners. So whenever you're afraid, whenever you're worried about anything, just every time you see one of these, remember that you are a winner, okay? Let's pray together. Lord Jesus, we pray that you will help us to know that we're winners through you, that you died and rose again so that we could be more than conquerors, that we could be better than winners. We will be victorious in everything, not through our own power, but through your power. So, Lord, I pray that you bless these children, that watch over them and protect them, bless their teachers, bless their parents, bless everybody who loves them and everybody they love. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now I want you to follow the crucifer and head to Children's Church. Let's join together in prayer. Gracious God, we do need to be reminded, especially when we're surrounded by the enemy, whether it be disease or sickness or sadness, whether it be worries about our lives or the lives of those we love, whatever the concern is, we pray, Lord, that you remind us that we can be victorious through you. Lord, that victory not only needs to be over those things that are outside of us. But sometimes, Lord, we especially need victory over the things that come from within us. We do things wrong. We sin. We leave undone things that we ought to do, and we do things we shouldn't do. So, Lord, we pray that you will remind us that your death and your resurrection gives us victory over these things that tempt us and overwhelm us. So, Lord, we pray that you will remind us within and without, inside of us and outside of us, that you are stronger than anything and anybody. So help us to put our trust in you, to put our faith in you, and to lean upon you and depend upon you. Forgive us of our sins. Give us grace and strength for every trial and tribulation. Give us healing from our diseases. Help us, Lord Jesus, to be forgiven and healed even of that worst disease of all, which is disobeying you. Help us to follow you and to be loyal to you in every way. Lord, it is too easy in this crazy world in which we find ourselves to be self-centered, to trust ourselves so much that we don't trust in who you are. So, Lord, hear our prayers. Hear our prayers for others. Hear our prayers for ourselves and for our world. Oh, Lord, we pray for peace. We pray for justice. We pray for mercy. We pray for all those who are hurting this day and those who are grieving. This is our prayer in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, the one who taught his disciples and has taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Our scripture lesson today is found in the book of Romans, where Paul writes in Romans chapter 8 some powerful words of encouragement. Powerful words of encouragement. This is not just the mediocre stuff. This is the good stuff. This is some of the best stuff in all the scripture. So pay close attention as I read from Romans chapter 8, starting at verse 26. In the same way, the Spirit helps us in our weakness. We do not know what we ought to pray for, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us through wordless groans. And he who searches our hearts knows the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for God's people in accordance with the will of God. And we know that in all things God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. For those God foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brothers and sisters. And those he predestined, he also called. Those he called, he also justified. Those he justified, he has also glorified. What then shall we say in response to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own Son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also, along with him, graciously give us all things? Who will bring any charge against those whom God has chosen? It is God who justifies. Who then is the one who condemns? No one. Christ Jesus, who died, more than that, who was raised to life, is at the right hand of God and is also interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of God, the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. But no, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is found in Christ Jesus our Lord. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. I want to tell you a story about a person by the name of Trudy Rosenfield. Trudy Rosenfield was from England, and she decided that she was going to come to America to visit with some family in California. She was looking forward to seeing her cousin Alan, who lived in San Jose, California. Unfortunately, after the long flight that took a whole day, Alan, her cousin, was at the airport waiting for her to arrive. And after 3 hours, her plane did not arrive. He didn't know what to do. So what he did was he contacted the airline and found out that the ticketing agent made a mistake, and instead of sending her to San Jose, California, sent her to San Jose, Costa Rica. Well, it could have been worse. However, there are jungles in Costa Rica, and where there's a jungle, there are always snakes. And I don't know about you, I'm scared of spiders, but snakes freak me out, needless to say. So, nevertheless, she was greeted with the words in broken Spanish, "Ma'am, you think you're in California, but you're actually in Costa Rica." Have you ever felt like that? You have the best laid plans. You know what you want to do. You know who you want to do it with. You know what you would like to eat. You know where the sights you would like to see. You have everything mapped out. Everything is just going to be perfect. Your retirement plan is all set. Your investments are all doing well. And then the bottom falls out. You think you're headed to sunny California, but you end up in the jungles of Costa Rica. That is the story not only of our lives, but it's the story of St. Paul's life. If you think about St. Paul's life, he was in prison as much as he was out of prison. He shared the gospel in all kinds of ways and all kinds of places, but he also declares in 1 Corinthians that he was beaten, he was stoned, he was whipped, he was shipwrecked. He spent a night and a day in the open ocean. He had about everything imaginable done to him that would rob him of his joy, but he had joy instead of sorrow. And this passage of Scripture in Romans chapter 8, it contains some of the most joyful reasons why we should have hope in God, even when our best laid plans turn out like we had not wanted them to. So, first of all, verse 28. God works all things together for the good of those who love Him, who are called according to His purpose. It's one of the most famous passages of Scripture. God works all things together for the good of those who love God and are called according to His purpose. Every good and perfect gift, James chapter 1 says in verse 26, come from our Father who is in heaven. So where do the bad things come from? They either come from the devil, or they come from people who are misbehaving, or they just come because they just come in this fallen world we live in. But every good thing that happens comes from God. So it says in verse 28, God works all things, A-double-L, all things together for the good of those who love Him. There was a doctor who was talking to one of his patients who had cancer, and he said to him, as this man was teetering back and forth between hope and despair, he said, you can either be a transmitter or you can be a person who is a transformer. You can either be a transmitter who transmits negative thoughts and negative beliefs to the people around you. Woe is me. It's never going to get any better. I'm just going to be out of sorts. I'm just going to die, and I'm going to be cranky until I do. You can be a transmitter and transmit negative thinking. Or you can be a person who is one who transforms that negativity and that bitterness, that anxiety, that sickness, and turn it into something positive. You can turn lemons into lemonade. So which are you? Are you a transmitter who turns everything into something negative and you just spread negativity everywhere? Or are you a transformer who transforms the negative and turns those lemons into lemonade? Paul, who went to prison more often than about anybody in the Bible, put together, combined, he talked about joy, that God is a God who can turn all things and work all things together for the good of those who love him and are called according to his purpose. There was an old hand at poker who put it this way: it's not the hand you're dealt that matters, it's how you play your hand. It's not the hand you're dealt that matters, it's how you play your hand. Paul himself does this. He shows us how. For instance, in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, he talks about having a health issue. He says, I was given a thorn in the flesh, a messenger of Satan. I want you to hear that. Not a messenger of God, but a messenger of Satan. Bad things come from the evil one, or people who are doing evil. Even sickness and disease as a result of the fall of Adam and Eve not following God's plan in the Garden of Eden. So he says, a thorn in the flesh was given to me, a messenger of Satan to torment me. To torment me. Three times I pleaded with the Lord to take it away from me. And we've done the same thing. But he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly about my weaknesses, so that Christ's power may rest on me. That is why, for Christ's sake, I delight in weaknesses, in insults, in hardships, in persecutions, in difficulties. For when I am weak, then I am strong. And he means in Jesus. He says the same thing in the book of Philippians. In Philippians chapter 4, he says in verse 13, I can do all things through him who gives me strength. So no matter how difficult the task is that is before you, no matter how much you feel surrounded by the enemy, you can call on the same passages of Scripture that Paul did. I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. And then a few verses later in chapter 4, Philippians 4:19, it says, and my God will meet all of your needs according to his glorious riches found in Christ Jesus. So Paul, who was in prison when he wrote this letter to the Philippians, he said, I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. My God will supply all my needs, not maybe all my wants, but all my needs according to his glorious riches in Christ Jesus our Lord. So the first thing we can remember from Romans chapter 8 is verse 28. God works all things together for the good of those who love him. Do you love him? That is the question. One person who loved him where things didn't work out the way they hoped, but turned out for the good, was a young man by the name of Terry Fox. Terry Fox was a Canadian teenager. He was 19 years of age. He'd gone to college on a basketball scholarship, and he had played his first year. The season had just concluded, and he had a hurting in his leg. It was just above his right knee. He went to the doctor, found out after they did all the tests that he had bone cancer, and they had to amputate his leg. They had to take away his, not only his leg, but his life, basketball. But his coach said to him, Terry, you can either let this cause you to become bitter, or you can let this cause you to become better. You need to remember all the things that God has given you rather than focusing on what you have lost. And so he was fitted with a prosthesis. He got used to that prosthesis. Then he moved on up and received one of those prosthetic devices, a new leg that had one of those metal kind of scoop-shaped items on it that allowed him to be able to run. And he decided he was going to become better and make the whole world better by raising money, by running across the whole country of Canada. And so he called it a marathon of hope. And do you know why he called it a marathon of hope? Because he averaged 26 miles every day. Every day he ran a marathon's length. Terry Fox. You may know that name. He inspired the people of Canada. He started in St. John's, Newfoundland, and started running across Canada 26 miles every day. He ran for 143 straight days, a marathon length, 26 miles every day for 143 days, 3,539 miles. And he had to stop. The cancer had come back and had spread to his lungs. But instead of giving up, he got on television and inspired people, telling them, even if I die, keep giving. We must defeat cancer. And so Terry Fox, 2 months later, at age 22, died. But the people of Canada and people who have given to the Terry Fox Foundation, who turned his lemons into lemonade, have raised over $1 billion, with a B, $1 billion for cancer research. Now, I hope nothing like that happens to you, but I've seen too much of that happen to all of you and all of us together. We can either become bitter or we can become better. We can trust the Lord that all things can work together for the good, even losing a leg of those who love God. And then the next verse that I find very encouraging in this passage of Scripture is verse 31, where it says, if God is for us, who can be against us? If God is for us, who can be against us? You think about that when you're going through a difficult time. If God is for you, it doesn't matter what people say about you. It doesn't matter what kind of grief you get. If God is for us, who can be against us? You know who caught a lot of grief? Abraham Lincoln. President Abraham Lincoln, whom we know is the great emancipator. Abraham Lincoln, whom most of us think is the greatest president the United States has ever had. But it's interesting what they discovered after April 14th, 1865, when he was shot at Ford's Theater at the conclusion of the Civil War. The South had been defeated, the Union was saved, and he and his wife end up watching this play at Ford's Theater, and John Wilkes Booth comes up behind him and shoots him in the back of the head. They take him to a boarding house across the street from Ford's Theater, and at about 8:23 the next morning, he dies. But they emptied his pockets, and for 70 years, Lincoln's family kept all of these items, and finally they donated them to the Library of Congress where they can be seen today. And this is what they found in his pockets. Two pairs of spectacles, which reminds me that when I worry about where are my reading glasses, Abraham Lincoln worried about the same thing. So he had two pairs of spectacles, a lens polisher. He had a pocket knife, which every man probably carries in their pocket. He had a watch fob. He had a linen handkerchief. And he had a brown leather pocketbook, a wallet, and had inside of it a $5 Confederate banknote, which is sort of ironic. He had a $5 Confederate banknote, but also in that brown leather wallet were 8 newspaper clippings talking about how good a job he was doing as president. Here's the point. If Abraham Lincoln, the great emancipator, the greatest president in the history of the United States, needed to be encouraged by those 8 newspaper clippings, then you better believe I need it. And you need it. We all need to be encouraged, and we don't need to carry it around in our billfolds or our pocketbooks. We need to carry it around in our minds and our hearts. If God is for us, who can be against us? If God is for us, who can be against us? Hold on to that thought. And then lastly, in verses 37 through 39, it's a wonderful passage of Scripture. And verses 37 and 39 of Romans chapter 8. Listen to these words again. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of Christ, the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. It's a wonderful phrase there. You're more than conquerors. It takes three words to say that in English, but it's only one word in the New Testament Greek, and it's the word hypernike, hypernike, as in that swoosh I showed the children for the children's sermon. Every time you see a swoosh this week, I want you to remember that you are more than a conqueror. Hypernike. We use the word hyper when we talk about an overactive child, right? I was one of those overactive children, and my grandmother would come at me with a spoon that looked like a shovel that was filled with water and three drops of paregaric. How many of you had to take paregaric as a child, either for your stomach colic or just to keep you calm down? I can still taste it today, and I was a happy child. And grandmother was a lot happier because of it. I was one of those hyperactive children. God bless teachers. That's all I've got to say. They've outlawed paregaric, I believe, nowadays. It is a narcotic, by the way. But at the same time, when I think of hyper, meaning above, above average energy, hyperactive, hyperbole, hyperbole, an overstatement of things, exaggeration. Hyperbole, by the way, bole is the Greek word for ball. It's also where we get our word for ballet. It means over, hyper, throw, to throw a ball. That's where bole comes from. It means, well, for instance, it's the origin in our word for ballet. When you have dancers who toss people across the stage and they land safely, I could never do that. Or when you think, unfortunately, about ballistic missiles, it's still the same word, that God is able to make us more than overcomers. We are more than conquerors. We are hyperbole. It is no hyperbole. It is a fact that through Jesus Christ, there is nothing that can defeat us. Neither height nor depth nor anything else in all creation will get the best of us if we keep our faith and trust through Christ Jesus our Lord. Simply put, but in the words of Shark Tank, but there's more. As a passage of Scripture, it's John's Gospel, the 20th chapter, verse 7. It's the scene when the women have come to the empty tomb and they've seen the grave clothes crumpled up, folded together, all in a mess. And then they go back and tell Peter and John, and Peter and John run toward the tomb, and they get there and they go inside and they see the grave clothes, the shroud, all crumpled up. But then they see over in the corner, if you look at John chapter 20, verse 7, there's one verse, a whole verse just about this one piece of Jesus' burial. It was his face cloth, and they said that it was folded neatly in the corner. Now, what does that mean? Why would that one line entail a whole scripture verse, not about the grave clothes that are crumpled up, but about the face cloth? What does that mean? What is the message? Well, here it is. Every Jewish child, male or female, knew this. Every servant in any Jewish home knew this, that when the elders of the family had eaten their meal and they were finished, they would crumple up their napkin, wad it up, toss it down. It meant, I'm done. But if they folded their napkin, just like that burial cloth, that face cloth, if they folded their napkin and put it beside their plate, and you know what that meant? It meant, I'm coming back. I'm not done. I'm coming back. So whenever you're going through a difficult time in life, know this: Jesus died for our sins and rose from the dead in order to prove it. For our forgiveness, he ascended into heaven, and as it says in Romans chapter 8, where he is seated at the right hand of God, interceding for us, speaking up for us, he's coming back to set things right, to make sure that injustice disappears, to make sure that sins are forgiven, to make sure that there's peace around this world of ours, to give us a new heaven and a new earth, where it's described in the book of Revelation in chapter 21, where it says very clearly, I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away. There was no longer any ocean. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down from heaven. And look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and they will be his people, and God himself will dwell with them, and there will be no more sadness. There will be no more death. He's coming back. There will be no more pain. There will be no more sorrow. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. He said, write this down. For these words are trustworthy and true. So do you believe that God can work all things together for the good of those who love him? Do you believe God is stronger? If God is for us, who can be against us? Do you believe that through Jesus we can be more than conquerors? Hypernike. I believe, and I pray you do as well. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, give us the grace and strength so that we might set our hearts and minds on who you are and how powerful you are, that you are trustworthy, and that through you we can win every battle, not in our own strength, but because of who you are and what you have done. Because you folded that face cloth, it reminds us you're coming back and you're going to make everything right. We long for that day, Lord Jesus. Please encourage each of us. Help us to find the strength, because we've been here today to put one foot in front of the other tomorrow and every day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Our closing hymn is number 160, Rejoice Ye Pure in Heart. I invite you to stand as you are able. may the peace of God that transcends all understanding guard your hearts and your minds through Christ Jesus our Lord. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.